This is Seppo Podcast number 6 with me, Rémy Miller. And today we will be discussing the book, The Knowing-Doing Gap, How Smart Companies Turn Knowledge into Action by Jeffrey Pfeffer and Robert Sutton. And over the past year and a half, out of all of the books I've read since then, this is the only one which I've completed twice. And that's for a few different reasons. One of them was that it was only several books after I had read this one, which I came up with an annotation process for my book, which helped me extract more information out of them and be able to apply them to my life more and just really understand them at a deeper level. And it became before I started doing that, so I wanted to go back and read it with my annotation process instead of just reading the words as they are and putting it back on the shelf. And in addition to that, it was also because this book was the perfect book for a transition in my life at this time. When I was going from an employer, working for an employer, I wasn't so fond of to working for an employer I'm very fond of. So it really helped me understand what it is that good companies and bad companies, what's the difference between them? And then as an individual employee or member of an organization in general, what can you do to be the best member you can, to bring the most benefit to others and to yourself? And of course, this can necessarily apply to real life because really anything can be an organization. You and your significant other or your roommate or your anybody that you interact with on a regular basis can be part of an organization, however small. And it's actually funny because I'm reading through the Gulag Archipelago right now by Alexander Solzhenitsyn, and part of the explanation of how he got convicted as a prisoner to go into this mid-20th century Russian concentration camp, essentially, was the fact that he was participating in an anti-Soviet agenda in an organization, and they classified an organization as anything of two or more people. So you know, they were really dropping the hammer on what exactly defined this. So yes, it can really teach us a lot of great things in that arena. And that's part of the reason why I reread it. It's very valuable. So how about we not delay and get started? So to the book here. But one of the most important insights from our research is that knowledge that is actually implemented is much more likely to be acquired from learning by doing than from learning by reading, listening, or even thinking. There is a limit to what we can do for you in this book, regardless of the insights we have acquired. One of our main recommendations is to engage more frequently in thoughtful action. Spend less time contemplating and talking about organizational problems. Take action. Taking action will generate experience from which you can learn. And I love that how this is on page 6 of chapter 1 of this book, because they really lay it out for you at the beginning that, yes, they have this knowledge, but it's really you that's got to do the work. And reading this, you know, recording the podcast now from the last time that I've finished the book, from the first time that I finished the book overall, you know, that probably it's probably been about almost 2 years since I first read the book. So thinking of to where I was 2 years ago is quite something. And I would say quite different, because it's this sentiment which I've really been an avid subscriber of over these past 2 years is not thinking as much, is doing more often. And one thing I've begun doing a lot is making checklists and doing things right away and asking questions when it occurs to me, because really when my experience with this is, when I started to try harder at getting things done, you know, turning my knowledge into action, I found that I'm much more forgetful than I thought I was. You know, before it was all up here, but that's not the best way to do things, because so much slips by. So much slips by. Of course, there is the feature of making checklists that it's possible that you leave an item off of the checklist, and then you say, oh, okay, you know, I completed my checklist, so I'm good to go. But in fact, you left one off of there, and now you're screwed. But for the magnitude of the type of tasks that will fall off the list, as well as how often that happens, really pales in comparison to what it's like not looking after your tasks at all and coming up for some, you know, coming up with some system or organization to address them in a way that caters to their individual urgency and importance. So if you're, so, you know, to bring it back to business, if you're working at a company, if you're working at a company and you have a lot of hesitation to implement some new plan, explain that nothing will be learned by continuing to plan. Perhaps you're in a group of other people and you're trying to get this idea across to them, that the longer they wait, the more outdated the info gets. So using, you know, there's a common expression about that it's better to have to act on a good plan now than a great plan later, which is to say that information becomes dated the moment from when you acquired it, and actually the moment from when it went out into the world. You could have acquired that information a lot later. So trying to wait around and ideate and philosophize about what the best course of action is and sitting around the table, throwing out ideas, that's effective only for so long, because you can overplan, overthink, overanalyze, and it's very easy to do all of those things, because perhaps it's a human bias where we want to say, okay, we have this plan for this thing, and this is exactly how it's going to work out. There are going to be no faults to this plan. Nothing's going to go awry or sideways. It's going to work out. And you know what? If we mitigate risk and plan for contingencies and we come up with the right plan, then we're not going to have any problems. So, you know, let's spend the time up front to come up with a good plan so that later on we'll be set. And that's true to some degree, but not to a large degree. Largely, it's more true that if you have a semblance of an idea of what you're doing now, and you're reasonably well set up on that front, then it's better to just go, see what happens. Because one, you can adjust on the fly, and even if you can't adjust on the fly, you can optimize that plan the next time around for becoming more successful. And it doesn't have to be the full plan of execution that you're acting on. It can be a small part of it. It could be the first 1%, 5%, 20% of that plan. You take a small step in that direction, see how it goes. And then once you actually have firsthand experience of what the course of action here is likely going to be, then at that point, can you regroup and plan more to get that 80% plan that you started with up to that 90% plan, that 95% plan, and close that gap of diminishing returns. And that's most certainly something I've been doing a lot. For example, in the professional workplace, when it comes to working with people across and up in the chain of command, it really applies everywhere, across, up, below. It's any person you interact with, really, is putting the plan out there. Because you can have a whole conversation with somebody about what to do, but it is highly valuable to any person, and you can instantly perceive it too. When you have a whole conversation with someone and they don't even need time to process that, they're not coming to you a day later, they're saying, okay, hey, I hear what you're saying. This is what I understand you're saying. Am I correct? And they say, you know, that what's so gratifying to me is when they say, actually, yeah, that's pretty well put, better than I said, actually. Whenever I hear that, oh, that's better than I could have put it or better than I put it, then that's when the full satisfaction comes in from that engagement, because that means that I am tuned into their perception so acutely that they think I understand their idea better than they do. And that gives someone just the greatest confidence and comfort you possibly could. So after you describe to them what you reckon their perception to be, their understanding to be, then you say, these are the steps I'm going to take, these are the actions, these are the, you know, this is my execution checklist for how I'm going to address this problem. And then you tell that to them, or maybe if it's in a workplace setting, you're not telling it to them verbally, maybe you're sending it to them in an email or some other form of text. And once you do that, then both of you are on the same page. You have confidence that you're going the right direction, so you can just plow through the work and you don't have to worry, oh my gosh, am I doing this right? Am I doing this wrong? And then the other person who's not doing that work, they have the confidence in knowing, okay, I can let this person run free. They understand what my intent is. They understand what the goals of this part of the project are, or up until this deadline. They know what has to be prioritized and everything else like that. Gosh, it brings such a relief to the team. If it's you and one other person or five other people, it brings relief to the whole team, because then let's say that the whole team isn't on board with this system and you're the only one doing it. Well, that still gives comfort and relief to the rest of the team, because they know, hey, somebody on this team understands what the boss is thinking. Even if I don't, and I don't want to bug the boss, or the boss is busy, or I can't access him somehow, I can go to this other guy on the team and he knows what's going on. The boss gave him the, you know, let's say the whole team isn't on this meeting. Okay, the boss gave him the okay that he understands what's happening. And even if you are the lowest level person in that meeting, people are going to look to you. They're going to say, hey, thank you for getting that understanding. You asked a question that I had, but I couldn't quite word well, or I was nervous to ask it, or hey, thanks for sending out that those notes at the end of that conversation that we had, so that we can all stay on board. And if you're on a good team, people will be immensely grateful for that. And if you're not in a good team, hopefully those actions will inspire others to do so and make and render it so that your team becomes good. It's really a critical element to the success of any team. So, back to the book. An intensive study of an effort to make a Hewlett-Packard HP manufacturing unit more effective reported, quote, by interviewing 13 such stakeholders from other departments, including procurement, process generation, engineering and finance, design team members discovered that communication between departments was poor, thus limiting the degree to which they learned from each other. Opportunities to share innovative process technologies or other sources of competitive advantage were being overlooked. The problems associated with transferring knowledge within HP have led Lou Platt, the CEO, to lament, I wish we knew what we knew at HP. Another study of the transfer of best practices or knowledge within firms noted, and then here's a little excerpt here. You would think that better practices would spread like wildfire in the entire organization. They don't. As William Bueller, senior vice president at Xerox, said, you can see a high-performance factory or office, but it doesn't just spread. One Baldrige winner said, we can have two plants right across the street from one another, and it's the damnedest thing to get them to transfer best practices. So this really goes to show that just because someone's doing something well doesn't mean it's going to spread, which goes to the point that I just made. That if you're on a team that you don't that you're not so hyped up about, and you're trying to take ownership of problems and situations and trying to get everybody on board so that understanding is ubiquitous and mutual, then, you know, it's not going to be a walk in the park. It's not going to be a walk in the park. There are going to be instances where your team is so obstinate to change, which is to say that the company culture is not readily permissible of change and positive improvement, because it's really the culture that defines how a group of people, how an organization acts. It's not so much the individual, because think about it. These days, if you're working in an organization, let's say you just have a 9-to-5 office job, and it's not something, and it's something that requires some degree of skill. You know, maybe it's computer programming, or maybe it's finance, or maybe it's architecture, or maybe it's something in healthcare. In one of the fields like these, you know, you're likely getting someone with a university education, with a post-secondary education. That person may have a graduate level degree. They may have an advanced degree. If not, they have an undergraduate degree, right? And if not, they are skilled enough to get that job in the first place. So think about it. What are the chances that you're going to be working with someone that has an IQ below 100? 100 is average, and every year the IQ increases by about 3 points from what I believe is called the Hawthorne effect, though I'm not sure. Don't quote me on that. But it's the tendency for IQ scores to increase 3 points every generation. So but the 100 is average every generation. They account for that. So what are the chances you're going to get someone with a below 100 IQ? Very, very low, right? So chances are this person is going to be able to understand what you're saying. And even if you're interacting with someone that is not the sharpest tool on the bookshelf, you know, even if they're not, you can explain something in a way clearly and simply enough so that almost anyone can understand it. And another thing that this part of the book lends to is to promote cross-training, essential to the optimal functioning of every business within multiple departments, is sharing working strategies and leadership principles. Step one, increase communications by each department, writing after action reports, which get released to every department. What was successful, failure, fun, boring. And this is actually a great idea for getting people engaged with one another. Maybe whether you have a big organization or small organization, you can get people that are in charge of their expertise. And you have them write, because writing is the ultimate form of sharing ideas, because through writing you can refine ideas, it helps you think better, it helps you detach from what you're saying, so therefore assess the situation in a more clear way, and you're able to share with others, like I said, what was successful, what were failures, fun, and it permits that greater freedom of movement, because then you know what to expect in different circumstances. And when you're aware of how other people in your organization are operating, you know how to make micro or even macro adjustments to your behavior as to come to the benefit of others. And not only that, but more easily slot into the cracks of inefficiency and unproductivity and growth as an organization. When you know what other people are doing and where they are excelling and where they need support, and you're able to address that, you're able to come up with solutions for where other people need support, and you're looking after others, hey, that's how you create a strong bond. When it's not just, hey, I'm doing my job, and I'm looking after myself, I'm making sure I'm doing what I need to do, and you just take that minimalist approach to working, then you're not going to get far, and your organization is not going to get far. You really need to scratch each other's backs. You know, really anything gets done by favors. You know, that's why calling in a favor is such a common expression, common thing to do. Because that's how we thrive as a species, is we do things for each other. If we did everything for ourselves, we would be nowhere. So remember, if you have an opportunity, a chance to help somebody out, do it. You know, if it's coming to an immense sacrifice for what you have to do, and then you're falling behind on your own stuff, then yes, you know, kind of look after your work first. Make sure that you're doing what you need to do. But once you have even 1% of flexibility to reach your hand out and help somebody else with a problem or difficulty or confusion that they're having, yeah, that's when tight bonds come. And this can come in the simplest things. I had this I had an experience recently where I realized this only after a few days of it going on, where there was a new hire at my company, and I want to be warm and welcoming to these people so that they think, hey, this is a cool organization where I can relax and I can do my work and I can be productive without the fear that people are judging me. So I think one of the great ways to do that is to just get to know the people in the organization. And when you're coming into a place when you're coming in new to a place, you're nice and green, it can be hard to reach out. And you don't know what it's like. It's like, oh, are people here generally nice and open and willing to talk? Or is it kind of more consecrated and siloed? Are people stuck in their cubicles and don't really wander out, so you don't really get that much of a connection to others? You don't really have a good sense of that. So that's why I want to reach out, and that's why I did. That's what I did with this new employee. We got out, got a coffee, and as it came to unfold a few weeks later, she was assigned to a project an ongoing project that I was working on, and she had to come on board kind of halfway through and help out with some stuff. And it really helped to even have that one coffee with her, because then it's not this like weird new person that's coming in and, okay, yeah, you know, she has to do this work and I have to describe it to her. Because I had that coffee with her and I understood a little bit about her history and a little bit about her personality and a little bit about her style of speech and everything like that, I had, even if it was only 1%, again, even if it was only 1%, I was better able to communicate with this individual and have us achieve a better goal. And you know, it turns out that she did a monster of a job anyway. And even though she was on it for a short time, she blew it out of park with making sure that we were getting where we need to be with that project. So, and I'm not saying it was my sole action that brought that about. But it's to say that maybe she would have felt less comfortable in that environment. If every person she talked to on the team was new, then, and she didn't feel like she had any support, you know, maybe she wouldn't have wanted to ask questions as much or bring up problems that she may have noticed, you know. So you really can't know a lot of times how much you're helping in situations like these based on, you know, these things like just trying to reach out to somebody in this instance. But it's more than zero. It's having more than a zero amount of impact. So that's important to keep in mind. Okay, back to the book here. What firms haven't done very much is build knowledge into products and services or develop new products and services based on knowledge. Furthermore, it is no item on the list of knowledge management projects that reflects implementing knowledge on an ongoing basis. One of the main reasons that knowledge management efforts are often divorced from day-to-day activities is that managers, consulting firms, and information technologists who design and build the systems for collecting, storing, and retrieving knowledge have limited, often inaccurate views of how people actually use knowledge in their jobs. Sociologists call this working knowledge. Knowledge management systems rarely reflect the fact that essential knowledge, including technical knowledge, is often transferred between people by stories, gossip, and by watching one another work. This is a process in which social interaction is often crucial. A recent study of 1,000 employees in business, government, and nonprofit organizations reported that, quote, most workplace learning goes on unbudgeted, unplanned, and uncaptured by the organization. Up to 70% of workplace learning is informal, unquote. This study by the Center for Workforce Development found that informal learning occurs in dozens of daily activities, including participating in meetings, interacting with customers, supervising or being supervised, mentoring others, communicating informally with peers, and training others on the job. Man, can you see why this is the only book I've recently, in the past about 1.5 years, have completed twice? Because there are just so many gems like this. That much of our learning occurs in times when we're not trying to, or when it's not outlined that, hey, this is a learning time. Because one of the things that I think is that has certainly helped me throughout the years is my reliance on my brain's mirror neurons. So mirror neurons are I really love the name of them because they're pretty descriptive. They are neurons which become activated. They fire up when they start firing when we see others doing things at its most basic. And one example is, this was incredibly helpful for me because my main sport that I'm any good at all is tennis. And I didn't play on any school teams, high school or university, or played in any group of any kind. A lot of my time spent learning tennis was against the wall. So there's the tennis courts, and then on some courts you'll have walls nearby, which are often, you know, which can be used for racquetball or squash or something like that. But a lot of people use them just to hit the tennis ball against the wall to practice. So that's what I did for like 3.5 hours a day, every day. And I would go home, you know, I would come home, and then after dinner, I would look at videos of different tutorials and lessons for different moves or technique in tennis on YouTube. And I didn't watch that much professional tennis, but I did watch a little bit, especially more breakdown videos, you know, not like sitting down watching the game, watching the match, but more so, yeah, breakdowns where people are analyzing their actions and their movements and techniques. And then I would go, you know, I would come home from school. And then the first thing I would do, because I wanted to capitalize on the daylight, is I would put my stuff down, do my homework right away. I would just kind of blast through it, get it out the way as soon as I could, drink a whole bunch of water, and then go out and play tennis. And my mom would get upset with me many times, because I would just go out and play until it wasn't dark anymore, and sometimes until it was dark and I only had one kind of park lamp that was on to allow me to see the tennis ball hitting against the wall and coming back. And I would go out there and just play for like 3.5 hours and then come back. And it was the drilling, and it was the looking on YouTube for this stuff, using YouTube as my teacher, and allowing my mirror neurons to just capture, okay, this is the position of their body, this is how long they get in position before they hit the ball, all things like this. My 100% of my tennis skill has come exclusively from informal learning, playing with others on the court, just rallying or playing a proper match or on YouTube or whatever. So it's really essential. And in the workplace setting, so of the ideas and principles which the company values, how are they being implemented at a moment to moment and assignment to assignment basis? Employees should be able to cite specific examples from recent experience. I mentioned culture earlier briefly. It should be so embedded in the company culture that when you are interacting with others, you're learning. It's not just, oh, the company set up this mandated learning, this educational time. We have to watch this video and then do this quiz based on what we learned. No, that's not how it works. It's how do you embed in the culture? Every moment is a moment to learn. And one thing I'm very fortunate to be a part of in my current organization is that a lot of the people I speak to, not everyone, but many of them read or have, if not read regularly, at least have offhand books that they've read and things that they've learned from them. Because I think reading is incredibly important for that, because that allows you to understand other people's perspectives, that allows you to look at information and synthesize it quickly, especially if you're actively engaging in what you're reading and being mindful to extract something out of it rather than just idly passing your eyes across letters on a page. You know, that's not going to do much for you. That can do some amount. But I'll tell you what, the difference in myself between looking at words until there are no more words left in the book versus highlighting and busting out my post-it notes to write my thoughts on the page and throwing a flag on the edge of the page, it really has me engage better. It has me understand information faster, which has helped me in my everyday conversations with other people, because I can hear what they're saying, synthesize it, and then regurgitate it. And that's what reading is. It's absorbing information, having it relate to yourself somehow, so that you know how to integrate it within yourself, so that you understand it, and then spitting it back out. So if there's one thing you can encourage at your organization, whether you are the CEO or whether you are a low-level person, is read. Encourage yourself to do it. Encourage others to do it. Talk about it so that people kind of feel like, hey, you know, this person reads a lot, or the people at this organization read a lot. So maybe I should go to that used bookstore down the street from me and pick something up, or get back to that book on my bookshelf that I have half finished, because it's really like it's a peer pressure that is never negatively oppressive, you know. I was having a conversation recently with someone where I read a book. She recommended me a book, so I read it, and then we had lunch together one day to talk about the book. And at one point in the conversation, we got onto the concept of reading in itself. And one of the points I made was really consolidated down to one sentence, where I said literacy is a superpower, because it's true. if you think about, okay, what is the best way to eliminate poverty and increase flourishing in any country or region in the world is to educate the women. That's just what you do. Women need to be educated and they need to be literate. And that's how any country or religion or anything like that is going to be as successful as it can be. And what's involved in educating in education, whether it's women or children or adult, you know, male adults or anything else, education in general, reading and writing. Those are the first things. And they're alliterative for a reason, because it's the first thing to remember that you need to do, because you can't get anywhere without reading and writing. Literally every door is closed to you when it comes to becoming more advanced in any skill or competency than reading or writing. And if the door isn't closed, you know, the door is going to be lighter rather than heavier to open, and unlocked rather than locked and having to barge through when you're wielding literacy. So very important. Back to the book here. Bit of a short one here. Knowledge management systems seem to work best when people who generate the knowledge are also those who store it, explain it to others, and coach them as they try to implement the knowledge. For example, HP's strategic planning, analysis, and modeling group has had success in transferring knowledge about supply chain management that has been implemented in many HP divisions. One of the reasons the group has been successful is that the same people who do this internal consulting are also responsible for storing and disseminating knowledge about it within the company. Corey Billington, head of this group, describes the job as, quote, part librarian, part consultant, and part coach, unquote. He is responsible for knowing the technical solutions and the stories surrounding the 150 or so consulting jobs his group has done within HP, so that he and others in his group can suggest ideas to help new internal clients and can actually coach the clients as they implement the ideas. So this is speaking to the efficacy of specialty or dedication. Because as he's saying, when you're generating the knowledge, when you're the person who is coming up with the ideas of how this existing system is going to improve or how this new system is going to work, you are the closest to it. And you really are so intimate that you're going to know how to navigate this the best. That's not to say you're the only one that should do it or nobody else can learn how to do it. But it's certainly the case that when you're involved with something, you should be involved with it. You shouldn't be touching it at rare occurrences in the hope that that is frequent enough to qualify being good enough at having the organization as a whole take on this new system or this new way of doing something that's been done in the past. So when some process is created, there must be follow-up, education, training, testing, and remedial training on the deficiency. So it's not just coming up with this system and informing other people about it. It's saying, hey, you're informing them about it, and then you're actually putting them through some type of exercises or training that have them work on this thing that they just learned. And then that's not the end of it. You actually need to see if the training they just went through are actually going to lead to changes in day-to-day and quarter-to-quarter, if they're going to be day-to-day and quarter-to-quarter changes in behavior and in, you know, projects, maybe you're getting more projects, you're completing projects faster, you're doing it on a lower budget, maybe all three if you're crazy. You need to see if it's actually working. And then that's not the end of it, because invariably, there are going to be some parts which are working better than others. Maybe your idea for how something will work out is actually working out in reality completely different, or it's working out the same, but you notice, hey, I didn't have this exposure to this other element here, or I had the exposure, but didn't count for it in my plan. So you can then go through remedial training after that testing and say, hey, this is what I noticed about what we're doing, and this is how we can actually make it even better. So it's super important. The dichotomy to balance here, though, is just because you are the mother or father of some new idea or practice within the organization, that doesn't mean you're the only one that can do it, or the only one that's qualified to do it, or that nobody else should have this information. Other people should be on board, and it might come to the point where you need support for this thing. And if you don't have the willingness or the ability / skill to talk to somebody else and describe to them exactly what's going on with the system you've developed, then it's not going to be very fun trying to propagate this idea or implement it. So let's go back here, back to the book. Honda, which has successfully imported lean production techniques to its plants in the United States, also believes in knowledge development and transfer through direct rather than vicarious experience. In its efforts to enhance quality, it uses a process that is short on meetings and presentations and long on direct observation. Honda emphasizes having people actually see quality defects directly. Production workers will often go to another part of the plant to see a car with a defect. Honda has a saying for this: actual part, actual situation. The philosophy is that when a person sees a quality problem, she/he is more likely to analyze it systematically, to communicate the problem more accurately to others, and to be motivated to find a preventative remedy. The U.S. Army and other military organizations provide another good example of learning and knowing by doing. When the Army is not in combat, it is constantly training for combat. Much of this training is done by having soldiers perform the very actions that will be necessary during wartime. Soldiers engaged in staged battles, drills, and other realistic simulations designed to have them observe, perform, and repeat the actions they will need to carry out in real combat. So this is essential because there's no substitute for experience. And that's something that that can really be, of course, it could be applied in any field or domain. But when you have something like automobile manufacturing or preparation for wartime, it becomes even more evident, because for something like manufacturing a car, it's a very, you know, you're making thousands or millions of these things, and there is a way to do it. You know, the car was engineered, it was designed, it's supposed to come together in a very specific way, in the exact same way as all the other ones like it. So it's a very tangible process of what is it like to become more competent at this task? What is that actually like? And in addition to that, what's the best way to take on what it's actually like? And the best way to do that is to see what it's actually like. You know, it's a positive feedback loop. Whereas if you're thrown into a room and you say, okay, learn, you're given every book on the topic of how to rivet a car together, and then you're thrown on the job, you're going to be clueless. You know, you're going to know how to hold the wrench. You're going to know which part goes where. But when it comes to actually making this thing go together quickly and making sure that the fit and finish is just right, you're not going to get that from reading. So just as I'm saying that reading is important because it inoculates you to situations you would never be able to encounter otherwise, you still have to do it. You still have to do it. And encourage this in your workplace also. If there is something that that maybe there is a new type of project that's coming along that doesn't quite fit into the archetype of things that the organization has done in the past. And pretty much everyone on the team, even the leadership of up above, is slightly clueless as to how to make this work. Say, hey, let's do it. We don't know exactly what we're doing, but let's do it, and then we can reevaluate and move on from there. Leaders should be perpetually training their subordinates, in fact, because the more of the leader's job that the subordinate can do, the more time the leader has to assist his boss and his boss and his boss. So training subordinates doesn't steal away opportunity, but actually allows for more growth. Because think about that. If you are at an organization and there is a fear that you're going to lose your job, that the person below you is trying to steal your job, trying to take your job, good. That's a good thing. You want that person to do that. You want that person to be proactive and take on more stuff and take on more difficult stuff, because that means you're able. You have more time to take on more difficult stuff that your boss is doing and that your peers are doing and that your subordinates are doing. You should be taking on as much difficult and unwanted stuff as possible, because that makes you an asset. When you are a person that does the work that everyone else is repulsed by, are you going to be valuable or invaluable? You're going to be one of the most valuable people there, because they know, hey, this guy is just sucking up work like a vacuum that none of us want to do. And if we get rid of him, the rest of our jobs are going to be bad. So you know what? Let's look after this guy. Maybe let's give him a raise. Maybe let's get him a nicer office chair. Maybe let's give him an extra day of paid time off a month. Or a quarter. Or whatever. The chances that you're going to get looked after are a lot better. And that everyone is going to succeed is going to be a lot better. So let's move on here, and this is something I would actually, I definitely would like to cover, because this is not exactly what I was thinking. Let's just go to the book and then we'll move on from there. Teamwork is not an enacted value at this firm. A failing common to most security firms and investment banks. He was talking about security firms and investment banks, of course, and essentially how these teamwork structures were set up and what are good ways to do it, bad ways to do it.
There's much talk about teams, and teamwork is often an articulated value, but few firms have team-based compensation, and the pay system instead encourages a star or free agent mentality. This look out for yourself point of view augurs poorly for the bankers' relationships with the analysts. They are too busy looking out for themselves in the short term, for their own transactions and deal flow, to worry about retaining someone years down the road. And this makes sense. If you want teams to perform optimally, compensate them based on team more so than the individual. So there's this is one example that they give and that the authors give. And it's really true, because it's a common thing that you hear, which is a vacation. They say, oh, at this quarter, the person to get the highest sales figure or whoever hits this milestone first is going to get a 4-day vacation in Sandals, Jamaica. that's one of these incentives that they come up with. And the problem with that is it is a zero-sum contest. So you have, let's say, these 10 people on the team. You have these 10 salespeople. They're trying to get 100 sales by the end of the month. And that means it's zero sum. That means one person is winning and everybody else is losing. And you tell me, when you're thinking about a team, do you want most of the people on your team losing? I'm pretty sure you don't.
I'm pretty sure that's not in your, that's not on your itinerary, is for your, is for your team members to fail. And that's what this does. One good thing to do is, and I've seen this before, which I think is a fantastic method for encouraging development as well as encouraging teamwork is not having zero sum, but in fact rewarding the individual for their own progress. So saying, hey, how many times have I said hey so far just on this podcast? I've seen it before where over the course of a year, 50% of that person's bonus at the end of the year is based on goals that they set out themselves and if they completed them. So if you set out three goals and you complete all three goals and you have something at the end of it to hold in your hand saying, I did it, this is my product, this is how I've done it, that's going to encourage that. You would think, oh, if you reward the individual like that and so big of a bonus is focused on themselves, then they're gonna you know, that's going backwards in the organization. That might be even worse than offering a 4-day expense paid trip to Sandals, Jamaica. But in fact, it's the opposite, because what does that mean when these personal goals, which are of course weaved into the benefit of the organization somehow, and you have an obligation to the company somehow, and you know that every other person somehow has an obligation to the organization, then it really makes everybody invested in one another, that you know that your actions somehow are benefiting others somehow, and that's really going to tie everyone together. So it's really thinking about, and of course there are lots of other methods to do this, which really means that there's no excuse not to do it. So keep in mind that it's not the blatant reward which is actually best for the functioning of the individual, the individuals, and the team as a whole. Back to the book here. For better or worse, people who want to get ahead in organizations or to achieve influence often learn that talking a lot helps them reach such goals, perhaps even more reliably than taking action or inspiring others to act. Once people achieve high status, they are expected to talk more than ever. Dominating the group's airtime is one way to let everyone know that they are still in charge. As we show next, business schools and management consulting firms reinforce the view that prestige is achieved by winning the conversational marketplace, not by being best at turning smart ideas into organizational action. Which goes exactly with what I was saying earlier about sitting in on a, let's say you're sitting in on a meeting, and it's being able to come up with the action points after that meeting that everyone agreed upon that we got to do, which is going to really get you someplace and is going to benefit the team as a whole. It's not by being the person to sit there and share all of the good ideas, you know, put out there all of the good ideas you have in your own head, because they're just ideas. Actions get nowhere with ideas to fuel them, but ideas get nowhere without actions to fuel them. It's mutual. Both are essential. But there's no change without action. No action without idea. So it is really the first step. If you want to be a baby in the development of a plan and only put out ideas, you can be a baby, but that's not going to mean that you're going to really have any stake in what's going on. So it's really the opposite of trying to gain the credulity of others by talking. As a leader, allowing the subordinates more talk time and room to plan reflects positively on the leader, because that means the team's operational capacity is strong and has been trained and informed. So
when even the low-level people in the group can have something to say about a situation and be able to come up with the good ideas, that means the leader's doing their job. That means that the leader has instilled a proper culture and a proper method of thinking that allows people other than him or herself to take the reins on things and to get them done. So here in the book, they go through, they do this sometimes where they have a topic, and then after they've covered all of the points, they'll make a bullet point list of the main elements to keep in mind. So this is my summarization of what they were talking about. One, promote, so this title is How Some Organizations Avoid Hollow Talk and Promote Action. So this is exactly what we want. This is exactly what we want. This is exactly what we're just talking about. Promoting into senior positions people who understand the organization's work processes. So this isn't just somebody, you know, somebody's worked here for X number of years, okay, they get a promotion now. It's actually demonstrating, do they know what we're doing and where we're going and why we're doing it? Two, a culture in which simple and common sense are complements to an idea. Because we all know that there are occurrences where somebody gets an ego stroke when you say, oh yeah, that's a complex plan. That's a pretty big plan with a lot of moving parts. It's like, yeah, I came up with that. You know, I was the mastermind behind this whole thing. It's like, no, that's an insult. If you hear, that's why when I hear, for example, with my writing, I had that happen recently at work where I was coming up with, I was doing some drafting of a narrative that we had to write for our project. And there are multiple faces to this narrative. There was one to use externally with our consultants and clients, etc. And there was one internally so that we have a guiding force behind what we're creating. And then essentially an elevator pitch version, a concept statement of what it is. It was two sentences. And then some keywords. Just some simple, straight, a list of keywords of things to keep in mind. So to really cover all bases, if you want the full explanation, you can look at the description, the narrative. If you just want the keywords with, hey, I need this thing to plant in my mind. I need one word on a page to let me come up with ideas. Then that's that. And one of the things that I heard was that it was well written and eloquent. And there were a few words in there that they had to look up in the dictionary. And at first I take that as an insult in some ways, you know, that I didn't write this thing simply enough so that they feel a full confidence in understanding it, that they don't have to look up a word in the dictionary. They don't have to read it through a second time to really internalize this. That's kind of an insult. Like, it should be so clear and simple up front that none of that is necessary, but they insisted that it was good still. So that was kind of the contrast that I was experiencing there. But generally speaking, when it comes to plans, you know, this was something very specific. When it comes to plans in general, yeah, they should be real simple. You should be able to tell that to anyone, and they should be able to tell it to anyone, no matter how high or low they are in the organization, and it work out. Three, action-oriented language with follow-up. So boom, that's exactly what I was talking about earlier in you know, sitting on this meeting and taking notes, is at the end of that meeting, understanding what it is that actually has to be done based on what you're talking about. That's a real skill. That's turning knowledge into action. That is transforming something which was once simply put out there by someone into, okay, this is how it's actually going to look.
So it's a factor. This is a two-step, a two-factor, a 1-2 punch here. It's not just about the action-oriented language. It's not just, hey, this is what we're going, you know, what needs to be done. It's also the follow-up. It's been said many times that a leader's that making an order is 10% of what a leader has to do. Not the rest of the 90% is making sure it gets done. 90% of what a person does, of what a leader does, is ensuring that the order or that the request or whatever is actually being carried out in the way that it should be. It's not just making the order. So it's putting that out there and then following up, saying if it's something somebody else is supposed to do, follow up on them. Say, hey, is there anything unexpected that came up? How are you finding this assignment? If it's yourself that's doing it, follow up with the other people in the team. Whether it's your direct supervisor or whether it's just among your peers, saying, hey, this is what I'm doing and this is what I found to be helpful, and you know, this is how I'm going to continue. Because that gives people security, like, oh, okay, this person is working on this problem hard, is coming up with different things of how to resolve it. You know, let me do that too. And finally, number four, reframing obstacles as new problems to resolve. So that's a simple one. Instead of seeing a roadblock up ahead as a pure hindrance to your activity, see it rather as, oh, okay, this is something that I can navigate around. So let me go ahead and navigate around it, figure out the best way to navigate around it instead of just freaking out that something's in the way. Back to the book. Okay. There are many reasons for a firm success, but one is that every manager is a working manager, doing a job as well as managing others. This even extends to co-founder and CEO James Goodnight, who spends significant percentage of his time programming and leading project development teams. When asked why he did programming and development work, he responded, running a big company like this is pretty boring. As a result, one is likely to find Goodnight working in an R&D building on a product development team as in his CEO office. What does this practice by Goodnight and other senior executives accomplish? First of all, by doing programming and development work, executives like Goodnight have more credibility with those who actually do the work. People cannot complain about a boss who does not understand their problems and issues when the boss himself does many of the same activities. Being involved in the actual work process also keeps them in touch with the core technology and work processes of the organization. By understanding the day-to-day issues in software development, customer requirements, schedules, and so forth, they constantly learn about the organization, the products, and the market by doing. The result is that leaders help everyone turn knowledge into action, and because they are intimately familiar with the work of the organization, SAS, which is the company, SAS executives are less likely to be taken in or misled by smart talk. Boom. That's it right there. That's just it right there. It's leading by doing. It's always staying humble. It's always getting down and doing the dirty work. You know what? That's the first example that comes to mind is I've listened to the Jocko podcast before, where Jocko Willink is talking about his time when he was in the military overseas. And one thing they have to do after they're at the firing range practicing shooting is they can't just leave the bullet shells all over the ground. They actually have to pick that up. It's called picking up brass. And even when Jocko was super high up,
well, I wouldn't say super high up, but he was, you know, multiple levels up in the chain of command. He was still out there picking up empty rounds on the ground with the other guys, because that's essential. You know, if the person you're working for is always sitting in their air-conditioned unit with their feet on the table, there's no way that you're going to have as much respect for him than if he's out there picking up refuse and garbage off of the ground with you. And that's the case in any organization. If you are running a janitorial company and you are the CEO of this janitorial company, and nobody sees you in the building, you know, putting supplies away or doing these kind of bottom of the barrel menial tasks, they're not going to think that the CEO has any relation to what they're doing at all. So it really requires engaging. And this is the thing. It all comes down to catering to what people want and to what people do. So if you see someone doing something, that means it's probably because they want to do it that way. They want to do that task, or they want to do it that way. And when they see that somebody else, especially if it's a higher level person, doing those things, especially if it's something they don't want to do, you know, maybe it's some part of the job that's not so pleasant, boss is helping out with that, it's gonna go a lot smoother. You know, an exemplary leader is an exemplary grunt. In fact, a great leader isn't someone who's this hoity-toity, high and mighty person. It's, you know, a good leader is someone who's just as good as the grunt. And if the leader doesn't understand or care about the everyday work processes at the bottom level, they can't know what's driving the business forward. Because somebody has to do this work. Whatever the CEO is coming up with, whatever plan the CEO is hatching, it actually has to be done. So if you're not showing to the people actually doing the doing that you can do the do also, you're going to sabotage. It's self-sabotage. Self-sabotage. So, back to the book. The GE, General Electric, cultural change process had two elements that ensured talk would not be the only thing that occurred. First, the talk itself entailed language that impelled action because of the specificity and sense of urgency it conveyed. Over time, this action-generating aspect of language improved as General Electric people learned what kinds of talk produced actions and what didn't. Quote, when ideas were presented that were focused and tangible, they were much more often accepted than vague and general recommendations, unquote. Second, the meetings did not end with dialogue, discussion, and presentations. Decisions were made and follow-up occurred to ensure that implementation was part of the process. In town meetings, the business leader was required to do something with the suggestions on the spot. The idea could be accepted or rejected immediately, or more information could be requested. But if more information was needed, the boss, quote, had to name a team and set a deadline for making a decision, unquote. Quote, by deciding on the spot how to handle each idea, the business leader was modeling the translation of dialogue into action. The purpose of the dialogue is purposeful action for the betterment of the business and not just conversation for its own sake, unquote. So this is just straight up turning knowledge into action. This is straight up taking a discussion, seeing what can be done about it. My suggestion, be that person. Be the person that does that. Be the person that even if you're the low-level guy, saying, this is what I understand, and from what I think about the people present, it seems like Team X over here is best equipped and has the most experience to handle something like this. What do y'all think? And then when you put that out there, that says, oh, okay, this person is thinking about what's the best way to resolve this problem. And you can bet that other people in the room are thinking, oh, thank God. Thank God somebody else stepped up and figured out how we actually move forward. You know, what do we do? What do we do? Because people want to be, it's true that people are definitely independent and can be defiant, but people oftentimes want to be led. They want the easy route in a way, which is to have the solution thought up for them and then they can act on that solution. So the more you turn yourself into the person that can do that, the more valuable you will be. It is the fact, act now instead of proclaiming to act later. Approve and disapprove actions instantly and set deadlines. Have a specific person be a driver of the change. So there is, of course, a balance here when it comes to making decisions. Yes, it's important to make decisions on the spot to demonstrate to others that, hey, we're not just about talk here. We're actually about doing. So that's what we're going to do. It has to be balanced, of course, with waiting and taking your time, because there's invariably going to be a deadline of some sort or other that is coming, and when it comes to driving the business forward like that, there's definitely an element there of having the time available to get all the information you need. Because you can be too rash on making decisions. So sometimes it's definitely necessary to say, hey, when do I have to make this decision? Next Thursday. Okay, I'll give you a decision next Thursday. Because there may be new information that comes along that will actually improve your decision. So I would say this. Make plans instantly. Make decisions when they have to be made. And you can include in the plan when a decision has to be reached, just like the CEO was doing here by pointing out, hey, Fred's team is going to handle this. And Fred, I would like a resolution on this. I would like a decision or an answer by next Thursday. Of course, there's also the element, as Colonel Glover Johns told us as Hackworth wrote about in About Face, the book About Face, be one step ahead of your boss, you know? So don't just give it to him on Thursday, give it to him in advance. And you know, there are just so many moving parts. There's stay one step ahead of your boss. There's a good plan now is better than a great plan later. There are all these contrasting elements. And that's the difficult part about leadership and working in an organization, is understanding how to balance these variables, which are different in every circumstance. So it's important to read books like this to know that these are actual problems. So when you're in situations like that, you can help better resolve them. Just like they said, you know, any amount of reading or learning or anything that you're doing is not enough. It's about being in that situation. However, when you read, your brain almost simulates that environment and kind of counts it as experience. So if you read about different instances of things happening, and then something similar occurs in reality, you're not going to be at a total loss, because you could be at a there are many times in my life and in everybody's life where you're just caught by complete unawares and you don't know what you're doing and you can't tell up from down in this situation. by reading and by coming to see how more situations play out, you're able to have a library of situations in your mind. And you can say, oh, this situation is 60% similar to something I read about. Okay, that 60%, I don't have to think about. I have to have zero fears about that first 60%. That's already sorted. I can focus all of my energy on this last 40%. So you're focusing on 40% of the problem rather than 100% of the problem. And that's a huge difference. Back to the book here. People and organizations that use memory as a substitute for thinking often do what has always been done without reflecting. Even when they realize that a new problem confronts the organization, problem solving means finding practices from the organization's past that seems right for solving the present problem. The organization's memory, embodied in precedents, customs, and often unknown origin, stories about how things have always been and used to be, and standard operating procedures become used as a substitute for taking wise action. We have also been amazed by how rapidly such precedents are established. So don't care about what the standard is, care about what works. And that's kind of a sentiment now that I'm returning to this book and seeing my annotations, that's something that I physically find myself saying more often is I don't care how it was done. I don't care about what was done in the past. I care about what actually works. And if what was done in the past has been around for 100 years for a good reason, because time and time again, when people have tried to do something different, it didn't work out. Okay, yes, I'm going to follow that. I'm going to follow this standard operating procedure or this foundational technique for doing this task. But when it comes to a lot of other things that aren't so steeped in history like that, yeah, I don't care how it's done. How the history of a certain, of how to do something, is almost irrelevant to me. I really don't care how something was done in the past, other than as a means of further grasping that task. You know, how other people did it in the past can tell you about what it's like to deal with this task. And so you can then think about how you will adapt it differently to your purposes so you can become successful with it. So precedent is there for a reason, but it can also be there for bad reasons. So be mindful of that. Moving on, back to the book. By bringing to the surface assumptions that are otherwise unconscious, interventions and decisions become much more mindful and incorporate what people know. We have learned that freeing ourselves from our organizations from the tyranny of mindless precedent requires that we surface the frequently implicit, theoretical foundations of that precedent, including the behavioral assumptions on which past decisions rest. Once we do so, it is possible to design different and better practices that reflect our conscious, mindful knowledge. So when there's tyranny or in an organization, when there is this is how it's done, and nobody can break free from that, that's when you're going to have a rigid organization that doesn't grow. And I have an example at an organization I used to work at. This company was a small company and had stayed small for quite some time, for quite many years. And one of the reasons that was the case was because there was this very strong, this is how things are done around here mentality. And I can cite 100 examples of that, but one of them was, I was working on a certain assignment, And chances were that I actually had some experience with this thing in the past. And you know, we were designing something, and designing something for a specific purpose. And I think it'll just be easier to give it exactly where we were designing a restaurant, and there was one part of the restaurant where, you know, there are certain requirements we need to have. You know, there's the point of sale machines, those computers that servers use to put in your orders, and there was access to the kitchen and all this stuff. And there was one moment where, because I've worked in a few restaurants over the years. And I said, hey, based on my experience actually working in restaurants, I made these design decisions because I know what it, you know, I know what it's like. And when I was doing it, this is kind of what annoyed me. So I implemented, I accounted for that in what I came up with. And you know, the boss came back to me saying, oh, just make it look this other way, and then we'll see what the client has to say. And you know, that was confusing for me for a few different reasons. And one of the things that got to me about it was it was this very strong, this is how things are done here type mentality that was fueling that thought. This is how things are going to go here, and that's the way it is. And when an employee gets inoculated to that time after time of this is how things are done, then that's when just all ownership and responsibility just gets completely absolved and then thrown out the window. Because it's like, okay, if this is how things are done, I'm just going to do how things are done, and then I'm going to leave it at that. You know, I did my part. I did my bit. And I did it how we're supposed to do it, and how we've apparently been doing it since the sun started rising, you know? So it can be very, very negative to growth. So, you know, in order for a company to get the most out of its foundational principles, it must be open to reevaluate the theoretical foundations of the precedents. If a principle is implied, you know, its relevance has to be tested to the current conditions. Because, again, precedents are established because the same thing worked in multiple circumstances over time, and that is a good thing. That helps us be more efficient, but it can also detract from our efficiency and productivity if we're not exactly handling that appropriately and making sure we're thinking when we need to think. Sometimes it's good to shut your brain off, get things done, get in the zone, get locked in. Other times, not so much. Back to the book. I really like this one here. One policy that encourages developing and applying knowledge is radical decentralization. I'll say that again. One policy that encourages developing and applying knowledge is radical decentralization. The company has only 5 levels even today. It's talking about this one company, AES. The company has only 5 levels even today, even though it operates nearly 100 power plants in 17 countries and has close to 40,000 people working for it, either directly or for joint ventures in which it is involved. Decentralization of decision making encourages people to learn because they know they will have the opportunity and indeed the responsibility to use their knowledge in their daily activities. The decentralization also facilitates the actual use of knowledge because it is the people on the front lines who get to make the decisions. The company's 1993 stock offering prospectus describes the decentralization. Most of the company's plants, so this is the excerpt, most of company's plants operate without shift supervisors. The project subsidiaries are responsible for all major facility-specific business functions, including financing and capital expenditures. Every AES person has been encouraged to participate in strategic planning and new plant design for the company. Wow. Think about how empowering that is. Every person has been encouraged to participate in strategic planning and new plant design for the company. You are taking every person and you are saying your opinion is so valuable, you can change the entire company. How empowering is that? Imagine if every person at an organization believed that this was true, that their opinion mattered, and that what they could do is actually going to come to just to everyone's benefit that they work for and work with. How about that? Wouldn't you love to hear that? This is really, you know, I'm almost tempted to just reread everything I just did because it's such an overlooked element that a lot of people get rid of. I've had this experience too, where there was such a total lack of decentralization. Actually, it was the opposite. I lied. It was a total abuse of decentralization because this is where it can go too far. It's good to decentralize. This is a very powerful page in the book. This part of the, so there's the chapter is when memories is substitute for thinking. And this is right under the subsection of building an organization that resists mindless action. And I've had the experience in the past where there was intense decentralization. And this is where it got out of hand because essentially the big boss, the big cheese at this company was decentralizing too many things. And he was handing off tasks that he should have been doing himself because he was upset with the way things were being done. He was upset with how his subordinates were doing work. That he said, okay, I'm unhappy with how my subordinates are doing work. I'm going to put it on my other subordinates to figure out how this is going to work. It's like, no, that's what leaders are for. When things aren't going right, it is the leader that steps up and says, hey, things aren't going right. That means that I haven't been, you know, either leading through example or communicating my expectations clearly enough for everyone to understand, or providing everyone the right resources and time available to do what I expect. So this is what I'm going to do. We're going to implement X, Y, and Z so that we're able to better reach these goals. But it wasn't that. Instead it was complaining that this thing was occurring and saying, okay, I'm going to make this somebody else's problem now. That's not how you build leadership capital. That's how you destroy leadership capital. That's how you completely deplete your meter of respect that people have for you is by handing off tasks that not only should you be doing yourself, but that you should be coming up with solutions for in the first place. And claiming responsibility for, because you are the leader. It is your responsibility. Decentralized command encourages people at every level to assume responsibility of tasks and projects because they know that learning about what they're doing will improve their daily activities and make them more enjoyable. So it's actually important for command to be decentralized so that people feel, oh, I actually have freedom of movement to do what I think necessary in this circumstance. Back to the book here. This section is talking about how sharing good news and bad news with other people in the organization. So back to the book, the executive assistant for one CEO told us she does all she can to avoid delivering news to her boss that will upset him because her job is less pleasant and more difficult to do when the boss is in a bad mood. To keep the CEO in a good mood, she avoids scheduling appointments with people who would deliver bad news to him about things, about how things are going in the company. This tendency for gatekeepers to screen out negative information means that leaders often develop remarkably inaccurate images of their organizations, believing that no action is needed, even though there is knowledge throughout much of the organization about the need for change and what needs to be done. For instance, NASA administrators developed inaccurate images about the failure of the space shuttle. The Nobel Prize-winning physicist Richard Feynman served on the Rogers Commission investigating the explosion of the Challenger space shuttle. Feynman asked a group of engineers to estimate the probability that the shuttle's main engine would fail. Their estimates ranged from 1 in 200 to 1 in 300. When Feynman asked their boss to make the same estimate, he proposed a failure rate of 1 in 100,000. Feynman asserted that this was just one of the many illustrations that managerial isolation from reality was rampant throughout NASA. Holy crap. That's amazing. Let's see. From 1 in 200 to 1 in 100,000, that is... Even taking 1 in 300, that's still, you know, orders of magnitude out of line. That is orders of magnitude completely misunderstood of what the reality is, which is crazy. And it's true that so I think what this is highlighting, humility. You have to stay humble, and you have to subordinate your ego, because if you're the CEO. And you may not even be doing this intentionally. So that's why you have to watch your behavior so closely, that if you're the CEO or a leader of any sort and people are scared to come to you with bad news, that means you are not going to be understanding what's actually happening. And how are you supposed to be successful as a leader and contribute to the success of the company when you don't even know what's going on? Like that's kind of step one, is understand what's going on, and then you're able to do something about it. Making informed decisions is paramount, for without correct info, no appropriate action is taken. Always prefer to know over not knowing, even if that hurting can be harmful to your ego. It's not going to be harmful to the situation, because it's better to know than not know. This is a major one here. This is a major one here, and this was particularly applicable. Like I said, I was going through a transition here of going from working at a company that I did not that I did not plan on staying at long term to a company I do plan on staying at long term, because of many elements, and this is one of the primary ones. Back to the book. By giving people a second chance, the company inspires gratitude and loyalty. Most of these people haven't been given a second chance or even much of a first chance before. The norm of reciprocity, virtually universally held and observed, requires that the favor of the extra chance be repaid. In addition, as Charlie Bressler explains, the firm has already selected the people as best it can and invested in their training. If it simply fires them at the first sign of trouble, it will have to go back to the same labor pool and hire again. What are the odds that it'll do significantly better? Bressler believes it is far more sensible to develop those people already in the firm rather than get rid of them. Go back into the same labor market and start all over with people who may not be better and could in fact be worse.
Second chances. Second chances are essential because it goes back to how we scratch each other's backs. You know, if you're in an organization where you feel like you have zero mobility to make any errors, and you have the impression that you should behave and work and act and think as conservatively as possible as to not derail the entire operation of whatever you're doing because it's so rigid, then that's when you're going to be just doing your job. You know, that's when you're going to be clocking out at 4:59 every day and doing exactly what you need to do and nothing more. It is forgiveness which permits creativity. And of course that creativity is what we need to actually improve. So the sentiment here is to repair, not replace. If a subordinate is not performing as she should, ask yourself, what am I doing in my behavior or explanation that is failing her understanding? She's not going to have a sub 100 IQ. Figure out what you're explaining wrong. Okay, back to the book here. I at this point, I'm looking at the left and right page, and there are highlights on both the left and right page. So they're two slightly different ideas, but still somewhat related. So here we go. It's talking about how different companies were going to fire a whole bunch of people. They had to make a whole bunch of layoffs, thousands and thousands of people. It's talking about Levi Strauss and Citibank. This was in, does it give us the year? In 1997. So this is quite some time back. So it's talking about how these two organizations laid off people, what they told them, what they did. And it talks about their differences. So without going through exactly what they did each, these differences illustrate four important guidelines for implementing stressful, negative changes in ways that reduce the fear that employees feel and the amount of fear in the organization. The key to driving out fear, even during difficult times, is to provide people as much prediction, understanding, control, and compassion as possible. Prediction. So the individual knows how to plan and ensure that their well-being and livelihood is secure. Understanding, so that they know that they're not being incriminated, they're not being prosecuted. And in fact, this is just the way things are, and they're trying to be as supportive as they can. Control, which means that this isn't a haphazard action of, oh, we need to make changes right away, let's do this and see if it works. It's no, make sure you know what you're doing and make sure it's unfolding in a kind of predicted way. And compassion. So not being evil to these people, not saying this is what you get and we're getting rid of you, but showing them a sense of love and looking after them and saying, hey, we're getting rid of you, but this is what we're going to do. It was talking about the differences and how one of them, you know, didn't say how many people were going to get laid off. They didn't say who was getting laid off, who's going to get affected the worst. You know, maybe some departments were going to get affected more than others. Didn't say anything about that. Didn't say anything about, when the layoff is effective. You know, are they getting fired immediately, or is this happening in 3 weeks from now or 3 months from now? You know, are they going to get any compensation? What are their benefits going to work? You know, so it all plays into that. And then of course, other organization did the opposite, said, this is a list of every person who's getting laid off. This is the date you're getting laid off. This is how much money we're going to give you after being laid off to transition into your next job. You know, they did all of that. Moving on to that was one highlight. The second highlight here is, Levi's employees, laid off or not laid off, had a good idea of what steps they would need to take to control their own destiny. those laid off knew what benefits they would receive and when. In contrast, and then it talks about Citi, which I kind of just explained. So I mentioned Jocko here in my sticky note. I say, even as Jocko says, when people feel like they have control over their fate, that's when they will make the hardest efforts to contribute. Trying to have subordinates get the job done on the basis of how it services yourself instead of how it allows them to flourish will lead to resentment and sabotage. And I like those two words I chose there, resentment and sabotage, because resentment is one of the worst emotions that you can have. And I have experience with that, with someone who I spent many years being close with in my life that I built up a resentment for based on his behavior. And it really restricts you from living. And when you are unable to exercise freedom in your thought and action because you harbor such an intense resentment for another person, you are bound. Just like Charlie Plum said, he was a fighter pilot in the Vietnam War and was in the Hanoi Hilton POW camp with several other American soldiers there. And one of the things that he said was that ultimately he thought that it was these, you know, the North Vietnamese guards looking over the American prisoners of war. The guards were the prisoners. They were the ones really in prison, because you know what? That war is going to end. It's eventually going to end. You know, they may not survive to see the end of it, the Americans, but it's going to end somehow. And it is these guards, it is these soldiers, the North Vietnamese Army, the NVA, which had to live with that. They had to live with what they were doing to others. After the war ended, they had to live with what they were going to continue to do, or how they had affected people's lives. So they were the prisoners there. And actually, this is one of the reasons that my favorite movie of all time is Prisoners with Jake Gyllenhaal and a lot of other big names in there, Hugh Jackman. It's my favorite movie because the movie's called Prisoners, and what I love is that what you come to learn, which is not really a spoiler, but it's really that everyone is a prisoner. There are some people which are more overtly prisoners than others, you know, like physical containment, but there are others who are prisoners of their minds, or prisoners of their dogma or doctrine, prisoner of their beliefs, prisoner of their convictions, of their line of work, prisoner of their compassion and love. Everyone's a prisoner. Prisoner of their mental stability. Everyone's a prisoner somehow. And it's really awesome because every character in the movie is a case study of what it's like to be a prisoner in some sense or another. And everyone in everyday life can be a prisoner. We have to see what the bars of our cell look like, and what the people that receives the turnkey looks like. What shape is it? And we need to find what that key looks like so that we can unconfine ourselves. Moving on here. In a sense, the underlying premise of the balanced scorecard is right. Measuring should embody a theory of organizational performance. So here they're talking about how they're tracking progress and performance in an organization and the different methods to do that. And one of them is a scorecard, which is essentially, you have these 10 categories of benchmarks of what you're supposed to be paying attention to in your job. And we're gonna judge you based on these categories. So continuing at Wainwright Industries, the five key indicators are in order of importance: 1, safety; 2, measures of employee internal customer satisfaction and continuous improvement; 3, customer satisfaction; 4, quality; and 5, financial importance. The relative importance of these various measures reflects the leader's beliefs about how the company and its business works. Quality is comparatively low in importance because at Wainwright, quality is an automatic result of employee satisfaction, training, and involvement. Similarly, for financial performance, strong business performance results from employee satisfaction, training, involvement, customer satisfaction, and highest product quality. It then goes on to talk about the key differences between firms that did the balanced scorecard approach. And this is a really good system because it's thinking from a first principles type perspective, where it's instead of saying, okay, the first thing that's, you know, what we want the most is a good quality product. So, okay, put that on the list. That's number one, good quality product. Well, actually pump the brakes there for a second, because when you think about it, a good quality product, it comes from somewhere. It comes from somewhere. So where does it come from? It comes from the parts of the product, yeah, but, you know, there's a group of people putting those parts together, and there's a group of people designing those parts, and there's a group of people making sure that the design of those parts are going well, and they fit into the finances of the business, and they fit into the standards of the time, and contemporary manufacturing standards that will make this thing cheap to produce, as well as getting good quality. You know, so it's about thinking the first principles, and what this comes down to is there are people doing blah, blah, blah. So it's really nice that their first two principles are safety, which directly affects the people, and then how happy those people are. If those are the first two things that are important to you, then that's probably a good sign. When poor quality is the concern, first attempt to adjust the satisfaction of the employee doing the work, as well as how well they were trained and their sense of involvement in the operation, or their meaning in the operation. So making sure they are up to snuff in terms of skill and competence to do what they need to do, as well as making them feel really integrated and supported by that community. That's what's essential there. So back to the book. Talking about competitive social identities here, and this one is starting kind of partway through because it's a long point that he's making here. So I'll loop back at the end. It's talking about internal competition. So we saw this process, internal competition leading to heightened boundaries and distinct social identities that limited the ability to learn from other units within the firm occur in case after case. And then it goes on to talk a case about General Motors. So this is partly what I was talking about earlier about this internal competition, the Sandals Jamaica prize. So the authors say, back to the book, one GM manager we interviewed recognized the dual-edge nature of identifying with a division within the total corporation, an identification that was encouraged by the decentralized multi-divisional structure and the competition between the divisions. So this is an excerpt again here. I worked for General Motors, but I worked for Pontiac, and my identity was 10 times stronger around Pontiac than it was General Motors. So I think the very thing that was our perceived strength at this point in time started to eat you alive. Because we'd get this very proud group of people, and then somebody comes in from the outside and says, I come from the particular division and we do great stuff.
We are probably more receptive to somebody that comes in from the outside that we hire and shares ideas with us than somebody who comes in from another unit within GM to share ideas. You say, what the hell are you guys so good about? What gives you the right to give us advice? So this is one danger of large companies. Is the division of departments. So one way to temper this may be to require after action reports to be shared and required across the whole company so that everybody knows what everybody else is up to. And when it comes time to learn from others, we can do that easily. That's something essential to every organization is cross training and cross understanding. So that people don't feel isolated and out of the loop and just stuck in their own department. And then when other people come along, they're obstinate to change and suggestions. So that's one thing that is not present at your organization. If the different departments or the different heads or the different processes are not integrated, or at least if not integrated, at least somewhat familiar with one another, then you're that siloing is most probably going to lead to just a very jagged approach to whatever the overarching goal of the company is. It's going to be very jagged and uneven because not every moving part is able to move in synchronicity. So keep that in mind as you think about what your role is in your organization. Perhaps part of your role is to integrate elements of your department with other departments. You know? Okay. Moving on. And here now we are talking about performance. So this chapter is called When Internal Competition Turns Friends into Enemies. So that's more so what we were talking about earlier with Sandals Jamaica. And this subsection is called Why Organizations Continue to Foster Dysfunctional Internal Competition. So this is right on the money here. So back to the book. Cohn's exhaustive review of the research literature on the effects of competition led him to conclude that, quote, the superior performance not only does not require competition, it usually seems to require its absence, unquote. The familiar competition to invariably foster superior performance is readily explained. Trying to do well and trying to be others are two different things. What does affect performance if it isn't competition? There's a large body of research showing the power of the self-fulfilling prophecy, also called the Pygmalion effect, on performance. Independently of skill, intelligence, or even past performance, when teachers believe that their students will perform well, they do. Independently of other factors, when leaders believe their subordinates will perform well, these positive expectations lead to better performance. Most of these studies show that the self-fulfilling prophecy occurs when the teachers or leaders believe, or act as if they believe, that a randomly selected subset of students or employees will perform better in contrast to some average or unknown group. So many studies have been done on this before where they'll take a group of people and whether let's just say it's students and teachers as it is in this case, and they'll say, oh, these seven students are actually, were previously in gifted programs. And that's what they'll tell the teachers. And then the teachers will bias towards that direction. And they'll give those students more attention in the classroom. And they'll be more forgiving towards them because, oh, it's, you know, they're not bad at this thing. They just, you know, they need a little more explanation or another chance or something. And that's how they get ahead. So that's why I hate the honors gifted kind of programs at schools because,
you know, it's baked into the system so much now that you kind of have to go by that. But I really wish it were different, because it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. If you took some, kids in the remedial English class and you put them in the honors class, they're really going to upgrade, because if the teaching is better, they're going to do better. If you continually, so in a business setting, if you're continually disparaging your subordinates because you believe that they can't do a good job, then of course they won't. You know, it goes back to the expression, take care of your men and your men will take care of you. Take care of your students and your students will take care of you. What does that mean? If you look after each of your students as if they're capable of something incredible, they're going to look after you. They're going to do their homework. They're going to participate in the class. They're going to do this and that. Something to keep in mind. Another comment on productivity here. Moving on. Talking about how Intel was implementing certain policies for competition, internal competition. So back to the book. And the facilities that were put into competition with each other were largely independent in terms of the maintenance activity, with little interdependence among the building maintenance activities across facilities. Competition is likely to be the most useful for this kind of task because not much new learning is required and there's low interdependence between units. So I don't know if it was this example, but essentially what he's talking about here is that there was one setup where there was like three different buildings and I don't know if it was another organization talking about something janitorial or it was janitorial something within Intel. But essentially, they could, the leader thought to pit buildings A, B, and C against each other because it was something like a janitorial duties. There's not much there to, there's no R&D. There's no research and development group in a janitorial service. It's pretty much just doing the work. So it's not like you're stifling creativity or anything like that. And they're also in separate buildings. So it's not like the people that they're encountering on a day-to-day basis, they're trying to compete against. They're actually trying to cooperate with those people to compete against the other buildings. So there are exceptions to the rule. There are certain situations where you can use internal competition within an organization to promote better work, but those opportunities are really few and far between, and you're better off thinking that you shouldn't do that. Competitive environments are productive only when the participating teams are not dependent on other teams for success, and the required tests themselves don't feature new things which need learning. Which is perfect in this janitorial example. Moving on. Back to the book. Similarly, in 1984, Apple Computer used the external threat of IBM to provide energy and a common enemy. In a speech Steve Jobs gave to nearly everyone in the company when he introduced the first Macintosh computer, Jobs portrayed IBM as trying to dominate the entire computer industry, the entire information age, and as posing a threat to the future freedom of the industry. This language helped to rally Apple employees in an effort to launch the Macintosh computer. The research literature going back decades is quite clear. One very effective way to reduce intergroup competition and conflict is to provide the groups struggling with each other with a common goal and a common external threat or enemy. This is a wonderful way of providing an external focus and a common social identity, us versus the outside competitors or threat. So foster competition when it unites the team against an external force, which everybody wants to oppose. We got to defeat them. Has powerful effects. So that one's pretty straightforward. You shouldn't be pitting your team against itself or other teams that team depends on. But when it comes to something that you're completely separated from, like another organization, yeah, that's when you start putting the blinders on when it comes to riling people up to do a good job. You're not trying to rile people up against themselves, but against others, which is what we were learning here. So moving on, and I'm going to read straight from this little excerpt here. One of the things we discovered was that there are certain basic things, values, vision, the culture of the firm, that are not up for discussion. You can discuss it in a sense of explaining it and understanding it, but it's not something that is going to be changed. It's important for people to understand that. When you become part of BGI, this company, this is what you are signing up for. And quite frankly, we've still got a small, hard core of our managing directors that are still questioning it. So we are at the point of saying to them, well, maybe it's best that you go someplace else because these things aren't up for discussion. So very good point here. There are precedents which most certainly can be overturned and should be because there are better ways of doing it now. But there are certain core principles to a company that can't change and that shouldn't change. And people have to get on board with that. For example, that one company that was talked about earlier in the book about safety being the number one priority and employee satisfaction being the number two out of the five. And those things aren't changing. And those things shouldn't change. And you have to make sure everyone's on board of that. There's no discussing that. And you attract what you emit. So if you're putting out there the culture of the firm and your vision and your values, you're most likely going to get people that also believe in that. So you are actually rewarded for defining these things well. And if you have an organization or you're within an organization that doesn't have these things clearly defined, that's a problem. Even the smallest business should have an idea of what they want to do and why they want to do it, and more importantly, how they're going to do it. Values and culture are the how. They are the smallest elements which make up the entire collection of how something gets done. So back to the book. Again, this is kind of mid-concept here, so I'll read the quote and then double back over it to explain a couple things. When the conversion date came, it was, according to Diane Loomley, a non-event. Everything worked perfectly. In fact, we are already prepared for the rest of the currency conversion that will occur over the next 3 years. So this is a company called European Economic and Monetary Union, the EMU, and that was actually a subsect of this company BGI that I mentioned earlier. So that's what they're talking about here. That they were going from using the franc in Europe to the euro. So that's the conversion that they were preparing for. And they had this conversion date coming up, and that they were saying it's a non-event, that they were so prepared for it that it's not even something to stress about. So continuing on here, Loomley noted that in the past, the firm had failed at large-scale projects. She maintained that the tremendous success of this project reflected the ability of the numerous functions and offices of the firm to work together effectively. This was a concrete indicator of the success of the training, the meetings, the communication, and all other things that had occurred to knit the firm together. So again, it's earlier in the book talking about the indirect learning, and it's the water cooler occurrences which really contribute to learning more than formalized events. And that's kind of what she's talking about here, where it was how the meetings are conducted, how action
is derived from knowledge and how people communicate and the relationships everyone had. That's what she said, occurred to knit the firm together, right? So it's these relationships that are built also, which contribute to this. And again, take care of your men. So because BGI invested so much time and resources into its people and ensured globally equitable treatment of all personnel, then when tough times came, people united and solved problems proactively. They were stepping up to the plate. They were saying, we got this, even though this is a change of currency. That doesn't happen all the time. There's a literal conversion of how people are using money. And you know what? It's going to be no factor because we got this, because our team is united. We know what we're doing and we know how to do it. Back to the book here. It's mentioning a variety of organizations here, from car manufacturing to apparel, talking about the men's warehouse. That's one of the businesses that they highlight as a fantastic business is the men's warehouse. And goes on to talk about turning knowledge into action. So the authors go through the entire book, giving these examples and discussing these topics. And the kind of the last chapter here is turning knowledge into action. So they're bringing it full circle. And the subsect of this chapter is 8 guidelines for action. Number 1, why before how? Philosophy is important. So going on here, back to the book. AES has a set of 4 core values, fun, fairness, integrity, and social responsibility that guide its behavior. It also has a set of core assumptions about people that it tries to implement in its management approach. That people, 1, are creative, thinking individuals capable of learning, 2, are responsible and can be held accountable, 3, are fallible, 4, desire to make positive contributions to society and like a challenge, and 5, are unique individuals deserving of respect, not numbers or machines. This is utterly true. This is utterly true about the nature of people. And even if it weren't, this ought to be the approach to leadership anyway, on account of the self-fulfilling prophecy. So even if people aren't creative and don't like to think and aren't capable of learning, and they don't like to be held accountable and responsible, and they're actually perfect, they're not fallible, and they actually want to contribute negatively to society, and they want the easiest way out, and people aren't that unique, they're just like lots of other people, and they, you know, they deserve to just be treated like workers that pump out work instead of being respected as an individual. So even if that were all the case, if you approach leadership with these sentiments in mind, the chances that you're going to have a successful team are a lot better. And these are, you know, these principles that, these assumptions, these core assumptions that AES came up with about people, about human nature, they very much, would contribute to a successful organization, any organization. That could be with your spouse at home. You know, think of your spouse as a creative thinking individual capable of learning. So if you have a problem with your spouse, you know, think of them as someone that can possibly change who they are or change how they understand something. That they can be held accountable, that they want to say, oh yeah, this was me, that I did this. Or that they want to contribute positively to home life, to the home living, right? When you assume these things and you make actions based on people wanting to behave in this way, you're really going to find a more sublime cooperation enter your life.
So wrapping up here, which is a concept related back to what we're talking about a good plan now is better than a great plan later, and this lends to that very nicely. This is point number three, which is action counts more than elegant plans and concepts, which almost enough in the title of this subsection tells you enough. But anyway, back to the book. A number of years ago, Tom Peters and Robert Waterman talked about the virtues of a ready fire aim approach to running organizations. We have seen that this principle of acting, even if you haven't had the time to fully plan the action, has two advantages. First, it creates opportunities for learning by doing, without taking some action, without being in the actual setting and confronting the actual part. Learning is more difficult and less efficient because it is not grounded in real experience. Second, the idea of firing and then aiming, or doing and then planning, helps to establish a cultural tone that action is valued and that talk and analysis without action are unacceptable, which they really are. Which is something, so I've been trying to make that change in my personal language in my life by not saying, having a conversation with someone and instead of saying, oh yeah, you know, we could do that. Yeah, we can do that. Or, oh, that'll work. Or that's a good idea. Oh, that's when I've been, you know, being very careful with, oh, that's a good idea. Because it's totally nice to tell people that, and people want to hear that. You're having a conversation with someone, you're trying to ideate about what you should do, and you tell someone, oh yeah, that's a really good idea. They get a little bit of ego stroke from that, and they're going to be more willing to give you more of their good ideas, and it's going to be better because they're going to be more charitable when you're sharing your ideas and picking out the best part of your ideas instead of cutting it down and telling you why it's not going to work, you know? So ready, fire, aim. Yeah. Saying in conversation, oh yeah, that's a good idea. This is what I'm going to do. That you had a good idea. You shared that with me. Therefore, this is how it gave me the idea to take this action. And it's really programming your mind to respond with action, to respond with, because of that, I will do this, not, oh, that's a good idea. You know, that's how you have useless meetings, for example, is you have a whole bunch of people talking about ideas, maybe saying other people's ideas are good, or saying other people's ideas are bad. Where's that getting you? Nowhere. Be the person in the room to say, this is what we will do. This is what I will do, right? Maybe point out particular people. Fred is the best person at this, so I think it'd be good if Fred did X, Y, and Z, if Susan did A, B, and C, and then I did L, M, and N, you know? And it just really makes sense, because if we learn by doing, that makes action more important than planning. I think everyone will pretty much universally agree that you learn more by doing. And if that's the case, it just necessarily follows that action is more important than planning. So in the workplace, encourage doing over thinking, then ensure after the fact reflection so that learning occurs. So of course you can't just do and be like, oh, I did it. And then that's the end of the line. No, you have to look back at it, reflect, and see if there's something more that you can learn from what you did. There's this one principle called the OODA loop. It's OODA, and let's see if I have it memorized. It's observe, orient, decide, act. So the first step is to get your bearings. Look around, see what's happening, take a step back, observe what's going on around you. What's actually happening? What are people doing? What are things doing? Where are things? That could be in a physical environment. That could be in a fiscal environment. What are the different moving parts? Observe what's going on and then orient yourself. So say, okay, all of these things are happening. This is where I am in the bigger picture. These are the different actions I can take that'll have these consequences. Think about the consequences of your inaction too. And then once you've contemplated all of those variables, then you decide, say, okay, I understand what's going on. This is what should be done. And then what I really like is that act is a different step than decide, because it's really easy. Yeah, we can do this, but then no one actually does anything about it. You know, it's the action, which is the most significant element of the whole thing. So keep this loop in mind, keep the OODA loop in mind. Remember that action is more important than planning, and that reflection always follows action. And you will set yourself up for a series of successes so surreal that you won't know what to do with yourself. That's how it's been like for me. You know, thinking about, like I said, I read this book about 2 years ago for the first time. Thinking about where I was 2 years ago in terms of doing things, I was so far behind. In the workplace, in terms of getting more things done and making sure the team is more supported, I've become more effective in my personal relationships with my friends and romantic relationships. They've become more successful because I've been thinking more in an action-oriented mindset. Like, what do I have to do for this to improve? Not just, oh, I want this to improve. Well, you know, what'll be better? And then finally, in my personal life, I've been more successful. So I had this one struggle when I was in university where I wanted to do it all, and I wanted to become, and even still, I'm fighting it now, this kind of desire to become successful soon. And I'm only in my mid-20s. So I know there's only so much, you know, time helps with all things. And to be successful comes over time. If it happens overnight, it's probably not a good sign. It's probably not a good sign that you're doing something worthwhile or that it'll last in general. And that's one thing I struggled with the university. I said, okay, I want to be successful. I want to do all these things that I want to do. And so I tried to do too much. This was a time also that was the most difficult semester of the entire program. And I said, okay, I want to do school. I also want to hang out with friends. I also want to practice cello. I also want to practice cello. I want to read more often. I want to write. It wasn't so much writing at the time, but I want to read more often. I want to play video games and work on them as well. At this time was when I was convinced I ought to be a game designer. So playing games and also building them myself. And I wanted to do 8 million things throughout the week and throughout the day where I just burned out, because I was trying to do too much and I didn't take into account time. I didn't say, okay, I can do this here. I can do that later. You know, instead of trying to cram video games, reading, hanging out with friends, schoolwork, video game, you know, all these things into one, you know, into one day or into 3 days, it was like, hey, let me do a little bit at a time so I can be more successful with this. Now, what you got to understand is that anything anyone has done has come from specialty. You know, it's important to be a T-shaped person where you're familiar with a lot of things, but you're really an expert in one, as opposed to a dash-shaped person where you're just kind of jack of all trades, or an I-shaped person, which is that you are, think of the capital letter I, where you're just, you know, one thing and one thing only. But I was going too far. I was going too far into dash shaped where I was doing too much. Now I have all of that under control and I'm spreading it over more time so that I still have my specialty, but I'm still enjoying life. I'm still, you know, for example, practicing cello is one of those things where it's easy to push off to the side, but it's like, hey, it's something that allows me to detach, to just disappear. Just allows me to disappear from the world and absorb myself into this mind-body interaction. and focus on something else. And it's also good for cognitive reserve, which is a concept in psychology, which basically describes how resistant you are to the different dementias of the brain and how to stave off those different dementias, building that cognitive reserve, which means participating in different tasks and activities, doing things that activate your brain in different ways. And if you're doing something like writing or doing something like finance or doing something like healthcare or doing something like architecture, and you know, if that's your main deal, but then you also have playing a musical instrument on the side, that's going to increase your cognitive reserve. That's going to be beneficial for you. It's going to be good for your stress levels, happiness levels, mental well-being. The interesting thing is, so the brain develops as you get older, and the brain grows from childhood all the way up to adulthood. And when your brain stops developing is at the age of 25. That is when the final part of your brain stops growing, which is the prefrontal cortex. That's the part right behind your forehead, which is the lobe dedicated largely to decision making, which is why you see a lot of young males doing stupid things because their brain isn't developed, but they are physically mature and powerful, so they can do stupid things without thinking about them. And the thing is that your brain starts growing up until the age of 25. That's when your prefrontal cortex stops growing, and then it starts to decline. So it's not like you hit 25 and then you continue and then you like plateau for a while and then you get old and that's when it starts going downhill. Once you hit the age of 25, it instantly starts going down. So if you were to look at kind of a line graph of this over time, your line is going up and up and up as you age. You hit 25 and then it instantly makes like a V shape and then starts going down again, starts declining on this line graph. So increase your cognitive reserve, participate in this variety of activities because once you hit 25, it's going down. So if you're not doing something to keep that up there, you are losing. You are literally losing. The number one predictor of that, by the way, is physical fitness and exercise. So if you want to stave off dementia as much as you can, keeping your cognitive reserve, keeping your brain power from declining over time, exercise. It is physical fitness and exercise is the one element which makes all other elements in your life better. So do it. And I've been learning to take my time with all of these things and make sure I'm metering them out properly. So that's what the knowing doing gap has taught me. And the knowing doing gap has fit into other books that I've read, which have taught me about how to live, for example, Extreme Ownership and The Dichotomy of Leadership by Jocko Willink. There's also How to Win Friends and Influence People, which has helped me with that. Really, any book I've read has helped me with my relationships with other people and trying to be successful and do more in life. I would also include The Team of Rivals, which is a book about Abraham Lincoln by Doris Keenan Goodwin, I believe is her name. And of course, there are other ones in there. One thing that has helped me just become more in tune with myself and understand myself, which has then in turn allowed me to do better in life, is Man and His Symbols by Carl Jung. So check that out. And I suggest you read books like this, which better inform how to live your life in a way that you think best, in the way that you want to live it. Eliminate that knowing-doing gap. Act. And that's about all I have for today. So thank you for listening. Check out other areas where you can see stuff. There are other podcasts. There are their Instagram uploads. Check things out like that. And for now, farewell.